Shore. My name is Caroline.
My name is Robbie. We're going to be your naturalists for this afternoon, and today we're looking at birds.
Can't sleep a lot at the desk. Let's head out to the feeders. Right over there on the trees, we've got a black-capped chickadee. Very common visitor to the feeders. They also have a very characteristic chickadee-dee-dee call that they use. And you can tell that they're black-capped chickadees by the black cap that they have on the top of their head. They've got white cheeks and then black on their throat. Hey, Robbie, do you know what's special about birds?
Is it their feathers?
Yeah, it is. Birds have awesome feathers. A lot of people associate feathers with flying, and of course, flying birds do have specialized flight feathers, but they also have feathers for many other functions, like keeping the rain off, staying warm, having lots of pretty colors.
Totally. Right, and not all those feathers are used for flying, but many birds in the wild do fly. Now, that's not unique to birds, because bats fly as well, and many birds, like penguins and ostriches, don't fly at all.
Another really awesome feature about birds are their scaly legs. Birds descended from dinosaurs, their ancestors used to be, and they evolved from dinosaurs. They are also closely related to reptiles, and you can notice the connection looking at their scaly legs.
An amazing thing about birds that you won't be able to tell just by looking at them is their bones, which are actually hollow for most birds. Everything about a bird is designed for it to be lightweight, so having hollow bones makes it easier for them to fly. Not all the birds will have hollow bones, because some of them that live in or on the water like to dive deep, and having hollow bones will make it tough for them to do that.
Birds will lay eggs. Some of them will have nests, but not all of them. And it's a very important part of their life cycle, building those nests and raising their families.
Let's take a minute here and just listen to the birds all around us. One of the things that I really enjoy about birds is listening to them and hearing the songs in the mating season, and all of the calls as well, the regular chatter between the birds.
Another really cool adaptation that birds have are their beaks. Their beaks can be all different shapes and sizes, and they use those beaks to get food. Their beaks are specialized to their food source. A lot of the birds we've been seeing here today at the feeders have beaks specifically for eating seeds, but there are so many other types of food that birds eat.
If you look at some of the woodpeckers that we're seeing around here at the feeders, you can tell that their beaks look much different than those seed-eating birds. They'll be a little bit longer and sturdier and more pointy to help the birds poke open the holes in the trees and then actually dig inside there and eat the little foods inside the tree. Gosh, Carol, I think that bird has a band on it.
Really? One of the awesome things we can learn by banding birds at Wolf Ridge is where they migrate.
Nice. Let's head back to the desk and talk about migration.
Let's do it. Awesome. Here's a map of North and South America, and all these arrows represent different pathways that birds will take as they're migrating. At Wolf Ridge here, we're located in a really cool spot, because as birds migrate, they've got a super huge obstruction in their way that's right on our doorstep. Do you know what it is, Robbie?
Lake Superior.
It's super huge. They could fly over it, but many of them choose to go around and that brings them right past the whole fridge.
To learn more about banding, let's head over to Lake Superior and see what they're up to.
So let's go look at some birds.
Wow. So everybody, here I am with Jackie. We're on the North Shore.
Hi, everybody.
See what we can find down here. This is a traditional nesting site. So we've seen birds here many years.
So the North Shore right now, we know of at least 25 different nesting spots.
Wow.
All natural, except for one in Silver Bay. But they found the spots all on their own, and we just got lucky enough to have somebody who told us about where the birds were coming and going from. And Palisade Head to this day holds the record for the most wild-produced peregrines out of any natural site in the upper Midwest.
Wow.
So right in our backyard. We have over 9,000 birds that have been banded since we started in 1981. It tells you where they came from. Anytime a report comes in from the banding lab that says a bird I banded in Duluth, Minnesota was found in Lima, Peru, 4,300 miles away.
Wow.
Which is the farthest migration we've ever had on a banded bird. This is Gremlin. Gremlin's a one-year-old male peregrine falcon, and he is of the largest subspecies of peregrine falcon found in the world. So the hood basically acts like blinders do on a horse. It helps to keep the bird calm while we're traveling, take away all that extra visual stimulation that's going to be really frightening. They can kill things up to the size of a Canada goose. They can kill sage grouse, sandhill cranes, and they don't migrate. So they are found on the northwest corner of the United States, Oregon, Washington, and then up into the Aleutian Islands into Alaska. So if you're gonna hunt things like puffins, geese, and large waterfowl, you kind of have to have some attitude, and he definitely has the attitude. Diving at 240 some miles an hour in a dive or a stoop with that one back toe, which is called their hallux, just striking you at the base of the skull is what can kill their prey. So they don't punch their food like we have thought for many years that falcons punch their food to kill it. Because how could a 1.5 pound bird kill something that's 8 to 10 pounds in size without really exerting a lot of pressure to it and oomph to it? And now with technology, we've actually used trained falconry birds and put them on quarries such as sage grouse, pheasants, quail, ducks, a lot of different things. And 9 times out of 10, they actually will strike with this back toe. And that's their killing toe. It's got the most power and grip.
Landing, we have bird feeders with wooden cutouts of people sitting at the benches. During a birds class at Wolf Ridge, when we take students to Chickadee Landing, the birds are less alarmed with the presence of people because they have been regularly feeding at the feeders with the wooden cutouts.
There's more you can do at your own home if you'd like to help save birds. We've got some cool like window clings. You can stick these to your window so that the birds don't fly into them and hurt themselves. This one I made just from an old calendar. You can cut out fun shapes or you can buy some. They come in these UV lights, so they reflect colors that birds can see better than humans. And they look really see-through. And these ones are actually shaped like hummingbirds. How fun. Another thing you can do to help birds and contribute to research is if you do find a bird that has a band on it, if you could report that, that would be really helpful for scientists. If you go online and just Google search report a bird band, you can find the bird banding laboratory website and report that band. If you know how it died, that's also really helpful for researchers to know, and you can help contribute to bird research and bird conservation.
If you are heading outside to look at birds, a great way to learn more about them and report your information is to document it, maybe in a nature journal. Here is my nature journal right here. It's a nice leather-bound one that was a gift for me a while back. And I take this out with me when I'm going on walks, and I draw some pictures and I do some writing in it as well. But you don't have to have a fancy book like this. All you really need is a piece of paper that you can fold in half, or many pieces of paper, and you staple them right here, and you've got a nature journal for you. Some other good examples. Something like this, you can add watercolors, colored pencils, markers, any sort of drawings or pictures are awesome to add to your nature journal.
Thanks all for joining us and exploring all the birds together. But you know, Robbie, I think we've been sitting down at this desk a bit too long.
Yeah, my knees can't take much more of this.
Mm. Let's go see what we can find outside.
Let's do it.
See you out there.
See you next time.
What you working on?
I'm making an earthwork.
What's an earthwork?
So an earthwork is art in the outdoors, and it's made from natural materials. So I've got snow, sticks, some lichen, and it's all temporary. Join us next week for
Earthworks.